Creating believable and immersive experience in cinema have always been challenging. Struggling with the limitation of two-dimensional screen, over the decades, cinematographers have pioneered techniques to overcome these limitations, such as techniques of sound, which can send you the vibrations of the distant rumble to trigger your imagination into anticipating chaos, which is approaching the scene even without a visual hint on the screen, or techniques of lighting, which can help you read the psychology of characters standing in the scene being viewed through a flat screen. Now, these techniques can completely change the outcome of simplest cinematic and take all your efforts of CGI and animation to the next level, making it more readable, immersive, and meaningful. This is Ram from Crossmind Studio, and today we are going to talk about the lighting setup for our scene which we have been creating for past 7 chapters, The Soul Stealer, from the animated content creation series, and also a bit of theory and why it is important to start putting thoughts into the lighting setup for your cinematics and visuals. Now, often when starting with the computer animation, it's easy for new artists to get lost in the smaller technical details and overlook these creative solutions industry have shaped for us over the decade. But I understand CGI is not an easy thing to start with, and there's a lot to focus on, lot to learn, and one could easily get lost and overlook these aspects. But it's important to look at the bigger picture sometimes, because at the end, what's seen in the frame is what matters the most. Sooner or later, you will realize, doesn't matter how detailed your CGI models are, if lighting is not done right, you will fail to capture a perfect picture and end up with a visual which doesn't say much. Now, here's a very simple example. I have a 3D model from 3dmodelheaven.com, which is pretty well detailed camera model. Now, you can render this out, but it will still remain just a sub which could be sitting anywhere in the world. There is no visual suggestion in the light, colors or shadows, and the visual is not really purposed for anything at this moment. Yes, you can throw in some lights, but if there are no thoughts behind it, you might would end up with very generic results. Now, if I make some changes here in the light, well, we have an object which is kept outdoors in daylight, but still quite generic. It doesn't say much. So let's tweak this a bit further. I added some warm color to the light, changed the angle of light, the shadows, and made it look like an evening shot instead. But this still looks quite harsh. So what I can do is turn on the gobo for the shadows. And this turns into a natural environment where subject is receiving shadows from the tree. It looks much more softer, much more pleasant. Here's another example of typical 3-point lighting and mostly used for the product shoot. One main key light which is illuminating the shape of the design, and one backlight which is kind of creating this contour and separating this from the background, and a fill light which is just enough so that it fills in the darker areas, but at the same time it's not making the image flat. So it's a very basic traditional setup for design visualizations and product photo shoot. Let's try some interior lighting now. Now here's another example, and there is hardly any presence of light, and mostly the light product is receiving is probably coming from the practical light sources like a lantern or bonfire or something like that. It kind of feels like a restaurant or something with old world setting, without much presence of artificial light sources around. Something on the similar line, but here I'm using lights from emitting objects in surrounding, like lantern and LED light of the camera. Now this example is lit with just sunlight, which is coming through the window, and rest of the scene is using objects to bounce around the light and fill in the dark areas. There are no other light sources, it's just the sunlight. Looks like a captured memory of good sunny day without any drama. Everything is well lit, warm, and quite pleasant visual. And now this example is quite opposite. It's dark, mysterious, and hardly any presence of natural light. Colors suggest you could anticipate some tension in the scene. Kind of lighting you would see in Black Mirror, Stranger Things, or Love and Robots. So dramatic, and there's kind of mystery, chaos going on in the scene. This one is just an experimental example. So this lighting setup is, even though the subject is same, environment is same, just with the play of light beams and reflections, it looks like maybe the subject is kept in a laboratory, or it's part of some crime show or comparatively modern environment. With the use of some volumetric shadows and glossy reflections, the look completely changed. Lighting the same object differently can completely change its meaning. While we were shuffling through the layers, we didn't actually make any changes in the model or the camera angle. It was just the lights, colors, and shadows. Now all these different moods are practically inspired by real-world examples. But lighting techniques can help you achieve these different moods from different times within an artificial set, which is probably completely dark or being shot in a warehouse. But that's not everything about lighting. Lighting can help you compose your frame to derive audience focus and guide them to where to look, where not to look, what to anticipate. It can guide the viewer's eye. Lighting can also help you create a picture which matches the emotion and psychology of the character within it. Just by adding different colors, adjusting the intensity with the play of the shadows, the harshness, the softness, it can mean so many different things in different scenarios. Also, many of the different genres heavily depend on the play of the light. Lights can give completely different meaning to emotions of the character just by changing the placement of the lights. For instance, a character smiling in bright daylight looks like this. And if I move the source under the character, it creates unease and sense of horror. It's a very common and popular example. Lighting can also help you create interesting transitions in your scene. For example, in Overwatch 2 cinematic, if you see when the war or the fight is going on, there's an overcast kind of weather and the shadows of the cloud and the smoke creates much darker tone. The characters are receiving light from the effects and explosions fire around them. As compared to when the war gets over, everything clears out and the entire scene is now receiving light from the sun, which is the main key light. The visual completely transforms into a happy, pleasant scene. Now, there are many kind of lighting techniques suited for different purpose. For instance, high key light, low key light, practical lighting, natural, fill, bounce, motivated, hard, soft, ambient, backlighting, etc., etc. But what is the right kind of lighting for your scene requires some thinking and planning. Learning to achieve your desired results takes time, and successfully creating the exact lighting effect you're looking for often comes with trial and error. Let's take two most popular type of lighting techniques, high key light and low key light. Now, high key light is technique where everything in the frame is brightly lit. The main key light source is larger enough to illuminate most of the scene, and there is less room for shadows, which means less contrast. The entire picture is readable, and larger light sources usually make softer shadows as well. This kind of lighting is often seen in commercials, pop music videos, mostly using brighter tones. Now, the low key light is exact opposite of it, bringing out the striking contrast with darker tones. Zero or very little amount of fill helps you create dark, mysterious picture. Now let's think about the scene we have for our assignment. The Soul Stealer scene which we have been making in this series during the past 7 chapters. Think the keywords that come into your mind before starting the lighting setup. What kind of emotions you want the scene to bring in the audience. Horror, mystery, darkness, magical. Basically what we need is some suspense and mystery. So for this scene, we definitely don't need anything brighter or on the lighter note. Instead, we are going to keep it dark without revealing everything and keeping it mysterious. Now, before we begin, I'm going to cut down any environment light which is falling on the set. So I'll go to the shader editor, and in the world setting, I'll just cut off the network for the environment, any HDRI if you have in the scene. And I'll also add a very little amount of fog with the volume scatter node, so that the scene can have some volumetric light effect going on instead of flat black, pitch black background. So let's start with the backlight first to bring out the shape of the magic potion in the dark environment. So it's always good to start with the main subject, and from there you can start working on the secondary things. Now that's a good start. I'm going to bring a fill light from the left, introducing a slightly cooler color, but keeping the source smaller so that it doesn't light up everything, but just a small portion to the left side of the set. Bringing in different colors can also help you create more depth in the environment, suggesting various light sources influencing the subject from distance. Now the foreground will have the glowing liquid that is coming out of the magic potion, spilled over ground and skulls. So it will emit some light, it's an artificial light source, and we could use a light of similar color and place it right under the skulls. Underlighting is often used to disfigure the face, often seen in horror movies. So it creates a sense of unease, a very good technique if you're trying to make the character look scary or creepy. And now more or less we have the main lights, a good start. But considering we are going for slightly less realistic and not exactly a true horror scene, we could use some more fills, and since we will be adding more smoke and volumetric effects later after the simulation part, so this dimly lit scene could become overshadowed. So let's add another light, keeping the direction somewhat similar to the main backlight, but this time more focus on the ground and slightly less intensity. This will also help light up the top of the skulls in the mid-ground. Now let's add another fill light on the foreground skulls, coming from the right. Very mild intensity, it's adding just enough light to make surface more readable. And adding some good specular highlights on the skulls. And one last light, which I think is completely optional, a very small source with hard shadows closer to the skulls in the mid-ground. Let's keep it spotlight just to focus on some specific area. Now this would help add some variation in smoke values later on when we have the smoke emitting from these skulls, also helping us add some readable surfaces in the mid-ground when the camera moves upwards. Alright, so this is looking good, and now let's go through our camera and see if there is anything that needs some extra attention. Now seems like the feathers are not much visible, and all that color information and the good work that you have put into it is kind of getting overshadowed. So in this case, maybe one backlight won't be enough. So a slightly smaller light source, a copy of the same backlight, we can make a smaller copy of the source and bring it near to the feathers, just so that those red tones, those colors kick in. Now similarly, I will make another spotlight and keep it narrow and focus on the right side of the skulls, which are situated at the base of the bottom. Now this way we can create slight rim light, just enough to bring out the shape of the skulls and at the same time not illuminating too much of the scene. Overall, I think this setup is good enough for our scene. Now this point onwards, you could run few experiments by tweaking few lights, changing the orientation. I myself had to play around a bit. This is definitely not the first attempt. Try out a few different setups and not settle on to the very first attempt that comes into your mind. So for now, I'm going to leave it as it is and tweak anything necessary later on once we have the more stuff in our scene, like the smoke and liquid. One fun thing about working with the CGI is that you can control the influences of the lights that are interacting with the volumes. In real world, this would be a very big challenge. So what I can do is I can choose which lights scatter through the fog and which one should not. So in this case, I have volume scatter enabled for just the backlight, foreground light, and green underlight. If I had kept volume scatter enabled for everything, the scene would get too foggy, and we don't want lights to light up the entire fog, revealing everything. So instead, most of the lights are toggled off for the fog, and just the backlight, foreground light, and the green underlight is what enabled for the volumetric scattered thing. So just for your information, you can toggle this property from the object property panel of the light source or any other object. Alright, so now let's select the main skull object and go to the material properties. So the idea behind this cinematic is that the magic potion liquid, the soul stealer, which is coming out of the bottle, is what killed these characters, basically stole the soul. And some of the liquid is still visible on the ground inside of these skulls, and the smoke is basically coming out of these skulls, the bodies of the characters, emitting magical green light. So on top of the main shader, we are going to bring a mix shader node and combine one emission shader with it. In the mix factor, I will bring in ambient occlusion just to catch those dark areas in the eye sockets and nose sockets. and keep it only inside. Now we can decrease the distance of the ambient occlusion and just tweak these values with the color ramp a bit. Now it's working. Alright, so it's working well, but we don't want all the skulls to have same kind of glow pattern. So I will mix the ambient occlusion with another texture. Let's bring Musgrave texture and mix it with the Mix RGB node and set the mod to multiply. Now this should work, maybe increase the intensity of Musgrave with the brightness and contrast node, so that it multiplies well and creates more contrast. So there we go, we have made through 8 chapters. And now our scene is not just a bunch of models or textures, but also have lighting which is just about right for this cinematic. It works with the kind of idea we had in the mind, with the mood and all that. And it does look like dark, mysterious, and have the right ambience that goes well with the subject. Reading this subject for the first time, learning this subject for the first time, the lighting. Please go online, try to understand different kind of lighting. This assignment is just focused around our scene. For the different kind of scenes, for different compositions, different mood situations, what kind of different light treatments you need. You can just start analyzing pictures from a different point of view and not just look at the details of the models. Try to read the patterns of the lights and the colors and start questioning things. There are plenty of articles. Internet is just filled with the information. Use it for the good. That's about it for today. In the next two chapters, we are going to add liquid and smoke simulation in the sea. If you are not familiar with it, please check out Month of Flow Simulation Introduction series so that you have good command over it before we begin in the complex scenario. If you have stumbled upon this chapter randomly, this is an ongoing series of about 12 chapters, which is about animated content creation. In previous chapters, we talked about the idea, storyboarding, animatic, 3D layout, camera modeling, texturing, shading, scattering, and all that, and made this scene. And today we made the lighting around it. So if you have been following along this series till now, I commend your patience and determination. I'm really looking forward to seeing your results on Instagram. Tag me with InstaCrossMind. I would also like to thank our patron for supporting this channel. If you are new to this channel, subscribe, and you can support us through YouTube membership, or if you're interested in special perks, do check out the Patreon page. Quite a new page, but we are still adding more stuff to it and trying to shape the benefits and the workshops and everything. Check out the playlist section on this channel. Share your results with me on Instagram. Tag me with InstaCrossMind. I will see you in the next chapter. Take care. Bye-bye. And thank you for tuning in.